Hello, friends and neighbors and countrymen. I'm going to try to be quick with this one today. Go ahead and tell you all now, go down there and subscribe to this, subscribe to my channel, like this video. I got a giveaway coming up. It's going to be a really nice prize for just as a thank you to everybody. And I'm going to choose the people that I'm going to draw a name at random with a number generator or something. May put everybody's name in a pot. I don't know. And anyway, I'm going to draw from my subscriber list. Anyway, today's June 6th, what we call D-Day. I think everybody knows what's going on. Everybody's over in 75th anniversary of D-Day, and President and everybody's been on TV all morning, as far as I know. I've been in PT and I just got out. I'm going to try to get this done quickly as I can so I can get it up today. Anyway, problem I'm having is a lot of people don't even know what D-Day is or what this is all about. And I just want to go over real quick a few things and make a point. I do have a list of an outline, like I said. I'm holding the phone in my hand. I'm going to try to steady it as much as possible on the steering wheel. But as promised, I'm going to try to stay on topic with this. So anyway, here we go. D-Day, June 6, 1944. It was one of the biggest operations of the Allied forces against the Axis. Probably one of the bloodiest days of the war. But the thing is, even though it was 1944, it started a long time before that. And I'm going to bring this all the way around to the end, and I'll make my point at the end. Actually, 100 years ago was World War I. And in World War I, it was trench warfare. It was horrible. You know, gas was used and all kind of things, and just slaughtered, just, you know, an ungodly amount of men and women, you know, lost their lives in that war, civilian and military. It kind of soured the stomach for the United States. You know, it wasn't really our war. It was way over there. Our guys went over there. They came home in a box. They came home messed up physically or mentally. And, you know, it just the whole country, it was the war to end all wars. We had, after it was done with, we scrapped most of our Navy, you know, cut defense spending in the budget and reduced our troop numbers and all this. Well, what we didn't know is that, or what they didn't know, is that, you know, 20, 25 years later, you know, this little Bavarian corporal named Hitler and a narcissist named Mussolini and Tojo, I'm not even going to try his name, but anyway, the Emperor of Japan, they got together and they decided that world domination was in their best interest. And they had a little meeting and they carved up the globe. You know, Japan's going to take all of Manchuria and China and Southeast Asia and the Pacific and part of Russia against the Pacific. You know, Germany was going to take all of Europe and North Africa and over to, you know, up through there and, of course, come across through Greenland, Iceland, up through there. And Italy was going to get Africa and all down that way. The problem with this was there were people in Europe, French, and never mind the French, England and Australia and some of the other countries that didn't want this to happen. You know, China didn't want it to happen. So even though we supported them, China and England and Europe, we didn't get involved in it. We'd lost our stomach for the war. And on top of that, we started embargoing. We wasn't selling any oil to them. We wasn't selling any goods to them, steel and such. So they were fairly aggressive against the United States over that. But it makes sense. I mean, nowadays there's a mass shooting and everybody says, well, where'd he buy the gun? He bought it legally at Joe's gun shop. And everybody's against Joe at his gun shop because he legally sold a gun to somebody. Well, we could have legally sold oil and materials to Japan and Italy and Germany, but we didn't. So we got on their crap list. But anyway, so that brings us around to World War II and what was actually going on. They were spreading out. Japan had taken over Manchuria and Korea and was moving into China. And Hitler had just kept marching and marching, and he was all the way down into France. And, of course, Mussolini was running around in North Africa in that area. But Hitler was sending buzz bombs and fighters and things into England. Men, women, and children that didn't have anything to do with the war, he was bombing the crap out of England regularly. You know, we had guys that were over there as advisors and civilians that were over there fighting against him and things like that. But, and like I said, in addition to all his humanitarian crimes against humanity, you know, he was also pretty bad character, and his armies were just taken over left and right. So anyway, so it was at this point and somewhere around the bombing of Pearl Harbor and everything, we decided, okay, we're going to get involved in all this. The problem is we almost waited too long, all right? And the reason I say we almost waited too long, Germany was right on the cusp of getting the A-bomb before we did. And they already, our Red Tails, and I know you've heard of the Red Tails, the Tuskegee Airmen, they actually went head-to-head with jet aircraft. You know, a couple of years later, and we would not have had the technology to actually pull this off. But anyway, June the 6th, 1944, 75 years ago today, and our troops hit the beach. There were 9,000-something, they said, killed and missing when it was all said and done. The first, second, and third waves, you know, were like 90%, 70%, and 50% casualties. These are guys that didn't even make it off the Higgins boat or didn't even make it to the beach. You know, they were just mowed down. These guys were something special. Now, unfortunately, I'm not sure if any of our kids nowadays would have that kind of guts, you know, to face down and charge down a machine gun, you know, across an open beach with no cover. Anyway, when everything was said and done, like I said, there were 9,000 something dead, lots of survivors, and we had a foothold that turned the war. It was only a year, 11 months, a year, something like that, later that it was over with. Once we got our toes on European soil and we started in the fight, we finished it. Which is a good, you know, a good yardstick for today even. When you go to war, when we send our military to war, we need to give them arms, give them ammunition, point them at the enemy, and say, go do your thing. None of these rules, don't load, don't shoot, don't shoot. No, it's the enemy. Kill the enemy until the enemy is no more and we have won the war. And that's it. But that's for another discussion. So anyway, the point I was going to make on this is, you know, I know five my grandpa Larson was in the Army Air Corps. Never knew him. He died before I was born. My grandfather and his four brothers. My grandfather was Joe White. His four brothers were Choi, Albert, and Charles. They went to Europe. They went to the Pacific. They went to North Africa. All four brothers went to fight in World War II. By the grace of God, all four came home. These gentlemen raised me. My grandfather raised me, and I raised me around his three brothers. These gentlemen formed the basis of my belief and value system. But as they've been saying today, they're all four dead now. As they were saying today, by the 100th anniversary, there will be no World War II veterans to attend the 100th anniversary of D-Day. There were very few this year. So, we need to pay attention to these guys. We need to learn the men who stormed that beach, whether they're alive today or they died on June 6, 1944. We need to study and figure out what was their belief system and their values at the time. And we need to teach that to our young people, because we're sorely missing that type of outlook in the United States today. We need to figure out what caused these men to, some of them 15 years old. Jack Lucas was 15 years old, 14 I think, turned 15, youngest recipient of the Medal of Honor. He forged signatures, went through basic training, and was on his way and got all the way to Hawaii, Pearl Harbor, and somebody figured out how old he was. And he was placed on barracks arrest, and he escaped and snuck on a ship and made it almost all the way to Iwo Jima and turned himself in so he wouldn't get in trouble because he didn't want to be lying about it. And they decided, you want to fight so bad, you know, get your rifle, get your equipment, and let's go. And he wound up jumping on two or three grenades, getting blown up, and surviving it and coming home and saving a bunch of other men's lives. But Jack Lucas, that's his name, look him up. Medal of Honor recipient from World War II, Marine. Anyway, like I said, we need to figure out what's going on with the value system in this country. You know, we've got those guys went and fought and came home and just shoved it back and said, okay, I'm done with that now. I'm going to go be a truck driver. I'm going to go run a shoe store. I'm going to go run a lumber company or a construction company. And they went on with their lives. 10% of them came home with what we would call now PTSD problems that crippled them up and they couldn't function. And nowadays our guys come home and 10% of them don't have the PTSD that cripples them up where they can't function. And there's a problem there. Something's different. And it's not the killing or the war, because that has remained the same. Killing's killing no matter where you do it. We just need to figure out what's going on. But these guys today, like I said, it's D-Day. It was called Operation Overlord. And we know it as D-Day. And the participants in Operation Overlord, whether they were the airborne and troops that went in the night before or the guys that hit the beach that morning, we owe them a lot. They are our heroes. We need to honor their deeds. These guys literally saved the world. You know, the veterans of World War II literally saved the world from domination by countries that were bent on killing and eliminating and executing everybody that didn't believe, you know, like they did. 11 million people in Germany we know about, and it never gets mentioned the almost a million people in Indochina the Orient, whatever you want to call it, that the Japanese killed, and no telling how many in North Africa. So that's what they did. They went in, took over, you thought like they did, and went to thinking like them, or they just killed you. And world domination is not something, anyway. So, like I said, we need to honor these people, honor their deeds, mainly honor their sacrifice. You know, they gave up a lot. And in, I think the best way we can do that, we need to honor their beliefs and their values. What were they made out of? What did they believe in? What did they value? Hey, it was, you know, mom and apple pie. It was God, you know, God and guns. And there's some ways you can find out, to be honest. If you want to know the feelings of most Americans at the time, go to YouTube and look. I know it's there. It could be some other places. Look up the director and the producers. I think his name is Frank Capra. And he did a whole eight movie series, Why We Fight. If you want a really good representation of what it was like for our troops during World War II, I can think of three. A lot of these new movies and stuff, you don't want to listen to them or even think about them, okay? There was no Captain America. There was no Inglourious Bastards. You know, a lot of that stuff is just made up. Go more for the history. Band of Brothers is a good one. Although most of it is, you know, Band of Brothers is factual. And although most of the next one is fantasy, because it never happened, Saving Private Ryan. Most of that was fantasy and just a conglomeration of different stories and things. If you want to know what it was like, you know, if you want to see something that was starring actual World War II veterans in the movie, watch a movie called The Longest Day. And it had every movie star from the time, you know, from John Wayne to, you know, Henry Fonda, and most of the people, you know, most of the actors in there, they served during World War II, The Longest Day. And that's probably the closest to the actual war a movie was made about the war. So everything was fresh in everybody's mind. You'll come closer to getting kind of the true story there. But like I said, kind of steer away from these newfangled movies, you know, Valkyrie, and, you know, no, none of that happened. Go with the stories, and like I said, Frank Capra's movieettes, his film series, was made right there at it, and it's a great history lesson. You know, liberals nowadays will try to tell you that it's twisted and it's propaganda. No, it's not propaganda. It is the truth about how things were. Even though they don't like hearing it, that is the way things were, and that is the way things, you know, people believed at the time. So, but yeah, we need to look at what happened at the time, learn about everything that Hitler did. And some of it was pretty gruesome and gory, and it's not going to be entertaining, some of it. It's actually going to be shocking. So, but we need to know this stuff, because we don't need to make that same mistake ever again, okay? We need to be sure that if there is an enemy out there, that we act. We don't make excuses. Well, they're not bad people. Well, the German people weren't bad either, if you take away the fact that they readily followed Hitler and condoned, and a lot of them just kind of turned a blind eye to him killing 11 million people that he deemed as, you know, unworthy of life. I'll just leave it at that. So yeah, they were good people. German people are good people now, but it's still there. You know, they still have to atone because their grandfathers and grandmothers turned a blind eye. You know, a lot of the kids in Germany right now, to be honest with you, a lot of them, the kids that were born during the war were Hitler youth. They were, you know, young men and young women were just thrown together and do what you do naturally. And they took the babies, and the babies belonged to Germany, to the Third Reich. It was a baby factory, and that was Hitler's little master race of future soldiers. It's historical. Look it up. But we need to watch. You know who I'm talking about, and I'm not going to say it because this will get the video taken away. But there are people that need to be watched, and there are people that really need to be gotten a handle on in this world. And if we don't do it and do it, as Barney Fife said, we need to nip it. Nip it in the bud. Nip it, nip it, nip it. Because if you don't nip it and you wait too long, it grows so large that by the time you do start fighting against it, you've got a long, protracted war, a long battle, and you can't hardly make any headway because it's grown so big and so strong. If you nip it while it's small, you're better off. And the only way that we know where we need to nip something is for us to learn from the past. If we forget about the past, if we don't pay attention to what has happened in the past, if we let ourselves be blinded, oh, they're good people. Oh, you can't talk bad about, don't say bad things about them. It'll upset them. They're killing people. Japan and Italy and Germany were on a kick of world domination, and they were in the business of killing people, exterminating races of people to take over the land so they could rule over it. World domination. Empire building. You know, we get accused of empire building because we want to bring democracy and freedom to other countries. That's not empire building. Empire building is when you go in and you kill everybody that won't listen to you and do as you tell them to do, and the rest of them are your slaves. You know, check out Chinese history. Check out Korean history. Check out, here you go. Look up Manchuria. Doesn't exist anymore, actually, because it was basically wiped out during World War II, and it was rolled into China. So, like I said, we need to know in our minds what's going on with this stuff, and we need to know what to fight against, and we need to strike when we know it. Don't wait. Don't let them infiltrate your country. Don't let them infiltrate your government and start destroying your country from within before you strike and say, no, this is enough. You are the enemy. All right? When you lose your stomach for self-defense, that's when you get killed. And that's what all this is. War against aggressive peoples to your own nation is self-defense. And like I said, we just don't need to repeat those mistakes. You know, act early and act decisively. So today, honor these guys. The men who died on D-Day died so we wouldn't have to go through this. So we wouldn't have a group of people that would come in and fundamentally change our nation and undo all the freedoms that we have. Anyway, like I said, I'll Frank Capra, Why We Fight. The other movie was Longest Day, The Longest Day. Another one was Saving Private Ryan. For the first 30, 45 minutes of it. And then Band of Brothers. It was a series. If you'll look at those three, you'll get a fairly decent idea of what the war was actually like, why we fought the war, and it'll give you a new respect for these guys. You know, of all the things you watch, look, you're watching me right now, why not watch them? Anyway, like I said, subscribe down below, hit the like button. If not necessarily if you like it, but just hit the like button because you think that this information maybe should be out there. Anyway, I would say happy D-Day, but it's not a happy day. It's a Memorial Day. Honor our dead, honor our soldiers. Love y'all. Later.